Wait before applauding. Can Europe play a key role in science? To answer such a question is quite a challenge and should be one for all of us. It demands a heightened consciousness and lucidity because the winds of policy change until now have been blowing in the wrong direction. The European Union has betrayed the idea of Europe, stifling its historical impulse for creativity. European citizens have been deprived of the possibility of experiencing valid creative discoveries, which represent the most satisfying, exciting, and human joy. We have been depriving of that, especially our young people. European citizens have been, by the same impulse, blocked from acting for the advantage of the other, which is a founding principle of European nation states embedded in the treaties of Westphalia. We have indulged in selfishness. We have been infantilized by the greed of the markets, the attacks of the oligarchy, and by the images of the medias. Compared to what is happening in the outside world, the win-win concept of the New Silk Road, the ongoing insurrection of many peoples against their exploitation, against their exclusion, and against their failed leaders, compared to the promises of a better world, we are here in Europe, in the valley of the clueless, not having today the excuse of a military occupation like East Germany had before the fall of the Berlin Wall. The Western Wall is crumbling, and our so-called leaders are blind and blinding most of us. My commitment is therefore to use this speech to take us for a journey outside the Valley of the Clueless. The Valley of the Clueless, run by a mutant form of the British Empire, and to take us into the future where our mandate is to build beyond. The historical enemy of the British Empire, Lyndon LaRouche, will lawfully be our guide in that scientific challenge to recover Europe so that it can play a role in science again. In its present shape, under the European Central Bank of Christine Lagarde and her controllers of the City of London, my answer of that capacity of Europe is as negative as the interest rates Lagarde is committed to enforce. Nonetheless, inspired by the optimism of Lyndon LaRouche, it is clear that we can bring to the world what it demands from us, provided we change our minds and open our eyes, not only for our own sake, but because the peoples of the world need us, associated to Russia, China, the United States, and India, to create the common future. We have to throw our delusions of an independent Europe down the river, the colonial delusion to divide and conquer down the river, and bring instead the best of our culture as a catalyzer for the world to come. The ongoing insurrection of the peoples in the world calls for justice and mutual development. But as Rosa Luxemburg said in her times, it is a mass strike ferment, which by itself cannot develop a vision, an articulated project for the future. They need those who among us can help them to show the way and lead the march. It is for that reason that the question of science is so important. The true scientist is in coherence with the impulse of a mass strike ferment, which is searching something that goes beyond the prevailing rules of the game. The true scientist explores, discovers, and inspires people beyond the existing logics. Our challenge is to bring our minds into the minds of those who have such capacity to create, in order to shape the social environment necessary to win over our enemies. If we leave to our enemies the control of the culture, we are doomed to fail. That's why we, Europeans, have to define a new manifold for our nations, freeing ourselves from a willing servitude to the oligarchy who control our habits. It is a very concrete question. I'm sorry to say it after the president's speech. What we have to stop being pragmatic, stop being ideologues, stop being geopoliticians. To do that, we have to first understand what true science, true creativity is. This is a purloined letter of Europe. The letter in the middle of the room, it is a historical contribution of our scientists. But most of us don't manage to see it, to see the letter. We have become as stupid as the proverbial Parisian cops of the story of Edgar Allan Poe. What is taught at school and in our universities, or even in the French high-level education schools, may be useful to behave in a predefined, deadly world. But it is fake science. When I was in my early 30s, I had a very, very strong doubt concerning the quality of what I was fed in those schools. And LaRouche challenged my mind with his ideas and confirmed those doubts. To play a role in science, one must first understand what science is. Sometimes, as a Muslim hadith says, we have to look for it as far as in China. Let's begin our journey at this starting point. Sébastien Drochon, Megan Beetz, and Jason Ross will accompany us later through our journey. Science is not statistics reflecting past trends. It is creation to master the future. The laws of the universe are not embedded within the domain of sense perception as such, but lie within man's ability to change the human behavior to such effect that man's per capita power over the universe willfully increases. As Lyndon LaRouche wrote, the key to the relative uniqueness of my own discoveries is a rejection of the parochial view of physical science. The parochial view of physical science. People who usually repeat physical science without understanding what it means should listen to that. The rejection of the parochial view of physical science, as customarily defined during the 20th century, and employing for physical science instead the standpoint of metaphor in classical art forms of poetry, drama, musical polyphony, and the plastic arts. An intuitive understanding of this statement can be guessed by a profound look at Leonardo da Vinci's paintings and into his notebooks, where elements of music, of drawings, of discoveries of principle, including the principle of a steam engine, appear in the same pages. Vasari reports that Leonardo had invited musicians and singers to come while he was painting the Mona Lisa in order to concentrate the mind in the domain of creation. And in one of Leonardo's many quotes comparing the different arts, later presented in his treatise of painting, where he notes the contentment that musical harmony produces in the ear, he adds the following for painting. Much more will be produced in painting by the proportioned beauty of an angelical face. A concertante harmony results in its proportions, which speaks to the eye at the same time that music speaks to the ear. And if such a harmony of beauty is shown to he who loves the one who served as a model, he will remain in stunned admiration and incomparable and superior joy to that of all other senses. In a different passage, you see how Da Vinci, inspired by his discoveries of physical principles, uses them as aesthetical elements in his paintings. His studies of fluid dynamics in water, air, led him to discover a pressure created by water or an air current on an obstacle in its passage lead to the creation of turbulences. Let's see the images that we have. This is how water circulation of an obstacle produces vortices. It's a phenomenon, it's a basis for the airlift. When we take off with a plane, that's it. The next one, that Leonardo's drawing of vortice formation in bird's wings. You see, it's a formation that makes the words fly. Next. That's a vortex formation around an obstacle in water, and he sees the common feature of both, air and water, and the vortex. Next. Oh, this is something quite interesting. As he describes it himself, observe the motion of a water surface, how it resembles hair, which has two motions. One comes from the weight of hair, the other from the curves of the curls. Thus, water has curly vortices. Fun. Our mind shall follow Leonardo's. The power, the flux, the dynamics outpaces, connects, and defines the particulars. In an Aristotelian world where we live, that's quite a challenge. Metaphor, in its true sense, is not just a figure of speech counterposing two words of different domains, but much more the predominant practice by which we select appropriate names for preconscious notions brought into the domain of consciousness. This is Lyndon LaRouche. This is not part of the politically correct opinion of science that prevails, since at least, I must say, to be polite, 50 years. For such a political correct view, science is based on logics, on induction and deduction. According to induction, if something happens many times, it will happen all the time and can therefore be considered as a law. Leibniz, on the contrary, called this consecutive thinking, the level of thinking of a poor dog beaten many times, never do it, but it happens, beaten many times, who as soon as he sees a stick runs away in fear of the proverbial speculator, this is another example, who jumps out of the 50-floor skyscraper and considers that if nothing happened to him during his fall through the first 49 floors, he will be safe, that's a law. Deduction, on the other hand, is defined by the capacity of deducing all the properties starting from a given concept. However, deduction can never forecast a transformation of that concept or a transformation of a set of axioms. For example, Aristotle himself defined the economy from the standpoint of a given set of families and slaves and a given modes of production, and deduced that in a world of limited resources, growth had to be limited and population growth controlled, including by friendly relations among individuals of the same sex. The other name of deduction is, of course, Malthusianism. Criminal Malthusianism. LaRouche's life was an unstoppable offensive against his culture of deaths. He relentlessly proclaimed that the cognitive functions within which discoveries of physical principles are generated are to be assimilated also to economic practice and to increases in the per capita physical powers of labor. This subject, he wrote in his work, Science is Not Statistics, the relationship between those distinctive cognitive powers of the human individual's mind and the increase of the relative population density of the human species is a foundation of all my professional accomplishments over more than four decades to the present date. He wrote that many years ago. And today, it's for us. This defense of what is human in a human individual is what inspired LaRouche's fight against Bertrand Russell and his intellectual disciples or protégés, Norbert Wiener, the inventor of the information theory, John von Neumann, and paradoxically, to man's minds with prejudice, his fight against both the liberal von Hayek and Hayek, but I like to say von, the liberal Hayek and the Marxist Karl Marx, in the name of Plato, Leibniz, G.F. Herbart, Karl Gauss, more than often, Lynn, with the polemical method of François Rabelais. The capacity to laugh at evil absurdities of mistakes of composition, is unique to mankind. Let's listen to LaRouche mocking Wiener. The starting point of my attack on Wiener's information theory hoax was inevitably the nature of the distinction between processes whose underlying order is overall entropic, as distinct from, for example, the species of living processes which are anti-entropic in their typical underlying distinction in ordering. What LaRouche is likely stating is that such a celebrated personality as Norbert Wiener mistakes the living for the non-living process, worse than a child. Europe, to come back to our subject matter, can only have a role to play in science if it recognizes that science is a means to fight against entropy, fostering gains in the productive powers of human labor, leading to increases in potential relative population density. It is not putting things together in a given nice order, taking notes and reading them. LaRouche again. The notion of contrast of entropy to anti-entropy lies outside what the ordinary university graduate considers mathematics. It lies within a higher metamathematical domain, which Leibniz defined as analysis situs. Negentropy, later called by LaRouche's anti-entropy and now by some dinantropy, is a type of ordering that can never be defined in terms of a statistical functions or any other deductive method of argument. An entropic universe would be doomed to death. And on the contrary, LaRouche, physical science is focused upon the nature of the ordering of successfully more powerful hypotheses. Thus, in this light, science becomes a matter of organizing the mental and related activities of groups of scientists and others around a task-oriented process, a mission of perpetuating scientific progress in this sense as a series of successfully more powerful hypotheses representing such progress and such process. It means it's absolutely non-linear. This is our mission and our task here now. We urge all of you to join this task for the safety of Europe and for all the good that Europe can and should bring to the world. Let me define now how I see this enterprise, the walk out of the valley of the clueless. First, we have to create appetite for change in ourselves and in our fellow citizens. Europe is an old sleeping lady who needs a scientific kick in the ass, not kisses in the lips, to awake her from her dream of reason. What world do we want? Do we want to continue to fall in the deadly comfort of a green pessimism, leading to a deep green chaos sponsored by their oligarchs' mentors? Do we want to continue thinking that our sons and grandsons will have a worse life than us or die in brutal destruction? Only 3% of the French think presently that their lives are going to be much better. 3%. 97% think that they are being worse. Only or else are we going to take our true non-mathematical, anti-entropic history of science seriously and decide to revive it again. For that, we have to define what infrastructure, industry, agriculture, and agro-food industry we need by thinking what the future generations and our general welfare need. We have to think with the eyes of the future and not with the blind eye of the money that we own or can issue. To bet on a real economic future means we must issue credit for advanced scientific discoveries and related economic developments. This credit must generate higher productive capacities and an open-ended cycle of creative discoveries of principle, technology, infrastructure, innovations, and education of the productive powers of labor for the benefit of all. We have to start from top down with new economics and social hypotheses, like when a scientist challenges the axioms and postulates of a given state of things in order to jump ahead for a better conjecture. Of course, the European Central Bank, the European Investment Bank, the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, and the whole euro system are in the enemy camp. The Environmental Funders Network and the European Climate Foundation promote the idea that you cannot have indefinite growth in a world of limited resources. Following who? Aristotle. And the criminal rules of the game of the 21st century associates of the British Empire. Excluding the potential of human creativity, which they fear, the choice is criminal depopulation. No delusion, none of them is good because they are all committed to various shades of entropy. They doom themselves to be criminals. We have to get rid of them by returning to our source of scientific creation in order to mobilize our creative powers and to inspire others. Our project for Europe is that it must play a role in science, truthful science. We have to think beyond the fake Europe, this European Union which must be dissolved. It must be dissolved. And go for enforced modes of cooperation among our nations for a mutual development. The choice is not, however, to go back to the rules of a geopolitical sovereignty like that of the British-dominated World War system, nor to fly forward towards the science fiction of a European or a world sovereignty, which are traps for human slaughter, but in favor of a win-win community of nations committed to the common aims of mankind. The One Belt, One Road initiative of China provides us with a tremendous opportunity to seize on condition that we focus on the long run. Our cooperation goes from the level of aerospace, space, nuclear fusion, disruptive technologies of the artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, supercomputers, to smart cities, environment and medicine for the elderly and against epidemics. All this as a world, as a whole. You can't separate issues and sell it in pieces. It has to be a whole, a coherent whole. In the future, we should seek cooperation with Chinese enterprises to drive a common global technological development for us in Europe and for the whole world. We have another tremendous opportunity in this conjunction where Trump and the American population want to stop the murderous military adventures of the responsibility to protect, the military-industrial complex. Trump recently denounced it publicly by name, even if we should rather call it military financial atrocity of the British Empire. That's what it is. But Trump has made a good step towards fighting it. We are now engaged in our European organization in putting together a coherent project embodying what we think and say. Our Schiller International Organizing is proceeding in the same way from Australia to the Americas. We need creative, inclusive, and connective developments with a coherent approach, and again, a coherent approach here and now. Energy, first. Nuclear energy has to be our common objective, both in terms of building nuclear reactors of the new generations and developing nuclear research reactors. France remains an example, even though we have mothballed this August our fast neutron reactor, Astrid, and that our megajoule testing device for laser fusion, the most advanced in the world with Lawrence Livermore, where we just had a breakthrough. This megajoule testing device is used for military purposes more than 75% of the time. ITER also represents a bid for the future, associating the European Union, China, India, Japan, Korea, Russia, and the United States. We also have to develop thorium molten salt reactors, the MSRs. Germany has fortunately kept most of its research reactors, but it's shutting down its reactors for electricity production, like Italy and Switzerland. We need, therefore, a new Euratom intelligent initiative. Intelligence, so to be intelligent. We have among us the best scientists and experts of the world in this area, which should be organized as a scientific task force. Again, it should be coherent. Space, second. The European Space Agency, ESA, has, in cooperation with Roscosmos, a program for landing a rover on Mars, ExoMars 2020. ESA is a proof that an association of European states, in this case with the Russian Roscosmos, can function in the best of all possible ways based on physical projects and not as a financial money bag as European Union and European Central Bank. There is also an association with NASA at the same time in this project for the Moon project. The European and Western astronauts, together with the Russians, founded in 1985, in the middle of the Cold War, the Association of Space Explorers, to promote space exploration, but also space science and engineering. Humans working in a creative environment and facing the unknown, having to have solutions, to find solutions to the unknown, to the challenge of the unknown, those human beings tend to become brothers because their humanity is enhanced by their common commitment and work. Europe, through the space program, can recover herself and gain a role to play in science. Third, transportation. The concept is to irrigate all Europe from the Atlantic to the Urals, extending towards the Sea of China, with a combination of canals for transporting bulk commodities, trains for all types of goods, trucks for delivery system around nodal points, and not to be all the time on the roads, and air transportation for emergency delivery of high-value parts. A priority must be given to the rail transportation in Eastern Europe, which has to be very urgently improved. Construction, fourth. All that is required for transportation and housing for our future development should be evaluated, both in terms of goods and manpower. The concept is to integrate the European, Eurasian, and Silk Road networks, the north-south and east-west bridges, connected at the different sites with the Mediterranean, the Atlantic, and the Pacific. Cooperation of European nations for the common development of Africa being the absolute priority. It is in that environment, and enhanced by a sense of mission, where Europeans play a role in science. The most important point is still to be made. A true scientific education requires that the educated person is made conscious of her, of his preconscious creative processes of memory and insight. LaRouche stresses that the generation of an experimentally testable new principle, a discovery of principle, occurs behind the opaque screen of the sovereignty of the individual's cognitive processes and is not representable in any system of communication. It cannot be represented in any system of existing communication. If it is thus, how can it be taught? How can this domain be explored? Is there a formal method by which to tackle the ontological paradoxes at the root of scientific discoveries? Of course, not in learning in a textbook fashion, as we were supposed to learn in those days. The solution is to replicate the discovery within one's own mind, and for that purpose, to create in the mind a closeness with artistic ideas, LaRouche, Leonardo, and many others, and especially with musical ideas, which have the same metaphorical origin as a scientific principle itself. Science is metaphor, tells us Lyndon LaRouche. This is why Einstein was playing violin and Leonardo had a such great interest in all forms of artistic composition, not only painting. The capacity to discover and assimilate new physical principles is nourished by an exploration of the preconscious domain of the artistic creation. That's why the dominant deductive methods of learning and of repeating after me an already discovered formula are so destructive, but still more destructive, fundamentally, and extremely difficult to remedy, are the flaws produced in the human mind by the separation of the domains of science and art. It is therefore the very foundations of our educational system that needs to be changed in order to free our minds to be able to play a role in science. We Europeans have references, many references, the concepts of education developed as a Renaissance, the Gaspard Monge and Lazare Carnot system of brigades at the École Polytechnique, before the rule of Napoleon, of course, where learning of musical composition, singing and painting completed the education received by students at what at that time the most advanced and powerful center of scientific and engineering work of all times. The humble tradition in the German education system and the German classics is another key point of reference. We are here in Europe in a space which, inside the constraints of the European Union, remains of the same size and even shrinks, by which is occupied by more and more people who have more and more filth in their minds, and where the exit doors are narrowing. It should come as no surprise if the criminal ideologues of the population and apostles of collapsology can introduce their ideas in such a polluted environment. I feel sometimes like Poe's character in The Pit and the Pendulum. Like him, we have an opportunity to seize at this moment of history, provided that we unleash creation in our minds and share it with the peoples that demand a better human life in the whole world today. That is a dimension of our challenge to deliver Europe so that she recovers her role to play in science. Will she? The answer is in each of us. Thank you.